Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. Would you open your Bibles, please, to 1 Peter chapter 1. And let's have a word of prayer together. Father, we thank you once again for the salvation that you have provided in Christ. We thank you for the potential of those that do not have a saving relationship with Jesus, that through the Word of God, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God, that they too could have this salvation. So, Father, we just pray this day as we look into your Word that you'll meet each one of us at our need. We pray that the Lord Jesus Christ is exalted, that he's honored, that he's glorified in all that we say and all that we do. Thank you once again for this gift of the Word of God, the Bible. And thank you, Father, we have the freedom and the liberty to open it up, to study it together. We thank you for the Spirit of God who is promised to be the one who guides us into all truth. So, Father, we make ourselves available. We desire to hear from you and you solely today. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. All right, so my style usually is to teach a book of the Bible, and for a few weeks we've bounced around a little bit and just kind of taken some topical messages, but I have felt led to go to 1 Peter. I think it's a timely book, and so, Lord willing, we're going to spend some time in that. Now, this week I got so excited that I actually went on Facebook, I believe it was yesterday, and was sharing some things that I was looking at. And in my excitement, didn't kind of figure out how that was going to work. We're probably not even going to get to that passage today. I don't think we're going to have time to get there. But we'll see how that all works out. And so anyhow, we'll start right in. And let's just open our Bibles to 1 Peter chapter 1, and we're going to start in verse 1. Now, I'm going to ask you, if you're going to stay with this as we go through this, that you might read the passages ahead of time. Get yourself familiar with the book and be prepared. We're not really reading ahead, so to speak. We're kind of taking this cold, so I'm just going to invite you to open your Bibles, and we're going to jump right in. And the first word is Peter. And I find this interesting because I didn't really have the time to work through this as I wanted to, so I'm just going to touch on it a little bit this morning. But when I opened up 1 Peter and I started studying it, I saw Peter. Obviously, I'm drawn to that. So Peter is followed by 2 Peter. And if I could have you turn to that very quickly. And 2 Peter starts with 2 Peter verse 1 of chapter 1. And it says Simon Peter. Well, that caught my attention. And you would say, why? Well, I would answer that. Simon Peter, and this one, as we look at back in the text we're looking at this morning, says Peter. So what I did is I started kind of wondering, is there a significance to that? And I'm probably going to leave you studying this kind of on your own, but I just want to maybe get some thoughts out there about this a little bit. If you'd turn, holding this text, because we're going to work out of 1 Peter today, but if you'd turn to Matthew chapter 4, and what we're going to do is we're going to look at the first mention of our dear friend Peter. And in the New Testament, obviously in the book of Matthew, we're going to get the first mention. So we have Matthew 4, verse 18. And walking by the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon, who was called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. Now you have the mention of the fact that his name is Simon, but he's also called Peter. So on our first mention, we have his two names here. Now, I think there's got to be a reason for that. So now I'll invite you to go to the same book, chapter 16, Matthew 16. And let's jump into the context here. Matthew 16, verse 13. Matthew 16, 13. Now when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he began asking his disciples, saying, who do men say that the Son of Man is? Good question, isn't it?
Yes.
Who do men say that the Son of Man is? And they said to him, some say John the Baptist, others Elijah, and still others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets. Verse 15, he said to them, but who do you say I am? That's the all-important question, isn't it? Because that's what it's going to come down to anyhow, sooner or later, is all of us are going to have to answer that question. And it really isn't going to matter what everybody else says that Jesus, or who they say that Jesus is. In answering that question, we're going to have to personally answer, who is Jesus? So, we see this character again who wrote this book that we're looking at this morning. So in verse 15, he said to them, but who do you say that I am? And notice what it says, Simon Peter, both names. Simon Peter answered and said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. If I had your Bibles, I'd be underscoring that, because that's key to the whole thing. Simon Peter answered and said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus answered and said to him, blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, because flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I also say to you that you are Petros. There's his name, Peter. You are Petros. You're a large fragment of rock. And upon this rock, let's be really careful with this, because I'm going to tell you something. If the church was built upon Peter, we wouldn't have much of a foundation. And that's just a fact. I also say to you that you are Peter, Petros. And upon this rock, what rock? That thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. That's the rock that the church is built upon. And upon this rock, that's Petra, the massive living rock. I will build my church, and the gates of Hades shall not overpower it. And there's a lot more to be said about that, but we're going to leave that. And I'm going to invite you to go back to 1 Peter, thinking about this first word again, Peter. Here's what I'd like to propose, and I really haven't studied it out for myself, but I'd like to whet your appetites that maybe you'd chase this through. See when he's referenced in the Gospels as Simon, and see when he's referenced as Peter. See when he's referenced as Simon Peter. Do you think these things are just kind of thrown in there for variety, or is there a purpose there? Jesus walks up to him, and Jesus has asked them to stay and pray. Remember that occasion? And Jesus comes up to him. How's he find Peter? He finds him asleep. What does he say to him, Peter? He says, Simon, why sleepest thou? So I think what we do is we see this individual calling Peter here. We see him sometimes Simon-like. And then we see him sometimes Peter-like. Sometimes he's like Simon. He's asleep at the wheel. Sometimes he's like Peter, and he has that firm, rock-like character. So I'm not going to say it's absolute, but I think it's a good study, isn't it? To kind of go through and say, as I read the Gospels, wow, what's going on here? Jesus called him Simon. Jesus called him Simon Peter. Or Jesus called him Peter. He's quite a character, isn't he? And he's been the brunt of preachers' attacks and jokes and illustrations for years and years and years. But what an amazing one he is. Do you remember the exchange when he is denied his Lord? And how many times did the Lord say, you'll deny me?
Three.
How many times did he come to him and say, do you love me? Three times. And there was a play on the words there. He said, let's go back and look at it, because I want to make sure we've got the right name again. That might be interesting. John 21. You realize at this rate we're never going to finish 1 Peter, right? Wow, I find it interesting. Look at the name he uses there. John 21, verse 15. Now he's denied the Lord three times. John 21, verse 15. John 21, 15. So when they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to, what's the name? Simon Peter. What's he calling? Simon. I think that's significant. Simon, son of John, do you agape me more than these? And he said to him, yes, Lord, you know that I phileo you. See, Jesus is using that supreme love, that sacrificial Calvary love. And Peter is saying, I've got strong affection for you. I really love you. Let's give Peter one thing. He's honest. Well, he might as well be because he's the Son of God. He knows what's in his heart anyhow. So he says to him, tend my lambs. Verse 16, he said to him again the second time, Simon, son of John, do you agape love me? Calvary love, sacrificial love? He said to him, yes, Lord, you know that I phileo love you. I have a tremendously strong affection for you, the strongest human affection that I can muster. He said to him, shepherd my sheep. He said to him the third time, Simon, son of John, do you phileo love me? Peter was grieved because he said to him the third time, do you love me? And he said, Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you. Jesus said to him, tend my sheep. Now look at this, verse 18. Truly, truly, I say to you, when you were younger and you used to girt yourself and walk wherever you wished, but when you grow old, you'll stretch out your hands and someone else will girt you and bring you to where you do not wish. Now he was saying this, signifying what kind of death he would glorify God. When he had spoken this to him, he said, follow me. What do you suppose Jesus is saying with that? He's saying, I get it, Peter. I understand you. I understand you even better than you understand you. And you're being pretty honest with us right now. I know that you don't have that agape love for me right now. But I think what he's saying is one day you will. See, I've called you Peter because that's who you are. You have a rock-like character. Let's go back to our epistle and see if we can make some hay in there for a little while. I'm encouraged in that because I really believe that God looks at us and he says, I know who you are. I know where I found you. I know what you're all about. But I know who you're going to be. I know who you can be. That's pretty encouraging. So Peter, 1 Peter 1:1. Peter. And we could have spent much more time with that because there's a lot of information about him. Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ. Do you see his credentials? He's like an ambassador. He's a representative of someone else. He goes on mission for someone else. He answers to that head. And that's a pretty important thing. Peter, a sent one of Jesus Christ. And now he goes on to tell us who he's writing to. To those who reside as aliens scattered throughout, and he lists a whole bunch of the regions, and they're important, but they're not so much important as to what they're there for. Peter, an apostle, a sent one of Jesus Christ, his representative, to those who reside as aliens. What's an alien? Those who are foreign. Those who belong and don't belong. Those who are residing in a foreign land. Those who are really not a part of that foreign land. They're aliens. They're strangers. And then he lists all of these Gentile areas that are pagan, unbelieving areas. And what he's saying is, I'm writing to those Christians who have been dispersed, that's the next word, dispersed or scattered throughout all of these regions. Make no mistake about it, you're in hostile territory. Church, can I tell you something? So are we. So are we. It's a foreign world. Have you realized that you don't always think the way that society and the culture thinks? You think differently sometimes. There's a reason for that. You're an alien. By design. So he says that he's an apostle of Jesus Christ. He's writing to those who reside as aliens. They're scattered throughout all of these literally pagan Gentile regions. They're believers in pockets throughout this area. And they're scattered there. And the thought has the idea of sowing seed. Well, let me ask you, who was the sower? Why are they there? Why are you where you are? Think that one through. God has scattered you, beloved, into the areas. Now, the majority was unbelievers. They're the minority. But that's still okay, because somebody scattered them there. Somebody who knows what he's doing. And by the way, it's okay to be different. It really is. Have you ever bought into that lie that when you're around a bunch of unbelievers that they want you to be just like them? They really don't. They really don't. They want you to be different. We're the hope. So they're scattered throughout all these different regions. Now look at this. I want you to buckle up because this is some pretty powerful stuff. Are you ready for it? You sure? This is pretty cool stuff. In Isaiah, God makes the comment that his ways are not our ways. His thoughts are not our thoughts. His thoughts and ways are so much higher than our thoughts and ways. And this is a passage like that. This is the word of God. This is God's revelation. This is God's information. This is not something we discover, not something we figure out. This is something God says. Now, if you are God, you have a right to do the things that this passage says that he does. Because of all of who he is. God is absolutely sovereign. He's the creator. He has the right to be God. Do you mind if he is? Will you let him be God? We set sometimes almost in judgment of God because of certain doctrines. We'll read those and go, what a God that would da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da, you know? I mean, come on. God is God. He doesn't answer to us. So we have to understand, when we look at some of these things, that God is God. But look at that next word, and I guess in some translations it's located differently, but Peter's writing to the aliens, those that have scattered a seed on purpose by God into these areas that the majority are unbelievers, and they're scattered there by purpose and on purpose. And it says, who are chosen? I mean, this is a breathtaking statement. I've never been able, in all the years that I've been a believer, I've never been able to wrap my mind around this thought of being chosen. But the Bible teaches it. And it says this, and I want you to see the Trinity in verse 2 as you kind of work into that a little bit. But you have God the Father, you have the Spirit, and you have Jesus Christ. They're all involved in this act of salvation. And it's absolutely breathtaking. So he talks about those who are scattered in these areas, and they're chosen. God chose them. God scattered them. Now, if I was one of them, I could sit back and say, this is such a tragic situation I'm in. I mean, I'm a believer, and there's just a few of us in this whole area. Woe is us. What are we going to do? Or I could understand why I'm there. It's breathtaking. By design. So I would maintain wherever you are, probably God is the author of that. Vocationally, you know, geographically, he has purpose. So they're chosen. Notice this first part, verse 2. They're chosen. Notice this. According to the foreknowledge of God the Father. That's pretty cool. That's pretty cool. God chose. Now, if you're a believer, God has chosen you. God the Father has chosen you according to his foreknowledge. Now, let's put this on God, because this is a rabbit trail we go down. Because somehow or other we want to get ourselves involved in this. And this is a rationale that we do. Though it may be true, I don't think it's right to look at it this way. What we do is we say, we're chosen by the foreknowledge of God. Therefore, God, through all eternity, looked forward. He saw me, and he said, he would receive my son, therefore I'll take him. Well, that makes it man-centered, doesn't it? I mean, really, doesn't it? It's not man-centered. It's from eternity past that God Almighty predetermined to choose you. I mean, that's it. Now, we can wrestle through all the theology in that if we want. That's not our purpose this morning. But hold your text again and go to Ephesians 1. Let's never be guilty of making our thoughts of God human, okay? Let's just not do that because he's God. So Ephesians 1:4. Jumping into the thought. Just as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world that we should be holy and blameless before him in love. Just as he chose us before the foundation of the world. Wrap your head around that. Ponder that one through for a little while. Before you did anything, before you even existed, God chose you. Before you did anything or didn't do anything, God chose you. So who chose? God chose. What was the basis of his choice? He chose. In his sovereignty, he chose. Don't work yourself in there to take a bow somehow or other, because you don't do that. God chose. So according, back in our text in 1 Peter 1, according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, we are chosen. Now, I don't understand that. But again, if it's in the Word of God, I'm going to read it. And I'm going to accept it as the truth. It goes on to say, by the sanctifying work of the Spirit. So we've talked about sanctification before. We've talked about being sanctified. The thought of that is being set apart. We would say being set apart for God. So here we have God the Father. That's in eternity, before the foundations of the earth, he chose. Then we have the Spirit of God setting apart. Now that's pretty amazing too. God the Father chose, the Spirit of God sets apart. I want you to, it goes on to say some things. By the sanctifying work of the Spirit, that you may obey Jesus Christ and be sprinkled with his blood. So being set apart, or the sanctifying work of the Spirit. Now I want you to go to John 16. The Spirit sets apart. John 16. So we're chosen according to the foreknowledge of God, and we by the sanctifying work of the Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit, and it talks about obeying Jesus Christ. So the Holy Spirit sets us apart. Let me ask you right at this point, we'll stop. Can you take a bow yet for your salvation? Can you take any credit for it at this point? From eternity past, before the foundation of the earth, God the Father chose you. Can you take any credit for that? Well, you didn't even exist. Now you are being sanctified or set apart. It's the sanctifying work of the Spirit. So just a little bit about what that looks like, and hopefully to give some clarification on it. In John 16, when Jesus is talking, verse 7, he says, "But I tell you the truth, it is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the Helper," we know that's the Holy Spirit, "will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. And when he comes, he will convict the world concerning sin, righteousness, and judgment." Now again, there's a lot being said here, and that's not our purpose, is to expound this passage, but I want to grab something out of it. In this idea of him sanctifying us, setting us apart, he's doing a work in our hearts that we can't do. He's revealing to us information that we don't have. He's enlightening us, and he's enabling us to come to faith. It's his work. It's not something we can do. So in that, convicting the world concerning sin, righteousness, and judgment, I just want us to read it. Verse 9, concerning sin. Because they do not believe in me. Underscore that one. The Spirit of God points out to the person that has not come to faith that they've got a problem. And the problem is unbelief. They do not believe in Jesus Christ and all that that means. That's what he does. That's setting people apart. That's setting people apart from unbelief to faith. There again, beloved, can you take a bow for this? You can't. There is one sin that'll damn a man to hell, and only one sin that'll damn a man to hell, and it's the rejection of Jesus Christ. Don't tell people to stop drinking. Don't tell people to stop smoking. Don't tell people to stop carousing. Share Jesus Christ with them. That's the sin that condemns a person. And he goes on, he talks more about it, and it's all important, but we're going to leave it and go back to our text. I'm going to remind us, Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, who to those who reside as aliens, scattered throughout all those regions, chosen according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, by the sanctifying work of the Spirit, being set apart by the Spirit, that you may obey, come to faith in Jesus Christ, and be sprinkled with his blood. Well, I guess I have to ask the question again. If that's the third part about it, and we have the Trinity involved, we have God the Father. Remember, he's the one whose foreknowledge he chose. We have the Holy Spirit, through his sanctifying work, that you may obey Jesus Christ, God the Son, and be sprinkled with his blood. So at this point again, can I in any way take a bow for anything that I've done here? Now I must be sprinkled with his blood. We have the Father choosing, the Spirit setting apart, and the blood of Christ cleansing. No, I'm going to back to a verse. I probably can quote it, but let me just back to it. I won't have you go there. I'm building a point here. I'm really laboring it. But at what point can I take a bow for any of this? I cannot. I can't. It's humbling. Yes, it is. But it's God exalting. He gets the glory, and he's worthy of it. And what it does is just causes me to love him with a passion that just grows and grows. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not as a result of works, lest any should boast. See, to me, that's what the gospel is. The gospel is always a Christ-exalting, man-humbling, God-honoring message. The pure gospel just draws your hearts to God because of all that he is and all that he has done. So we'll round that thought out, that you may obey Jesus Christ and be sprinkled with his blood. For God made him to be sin, who knew no sin, that you may become the righteousness of God in him. Do you see the sacrifice? Do you see the blood? It's the pure gospel again. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. The wages of sin is death. But God manifested his love toward us. And while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. You see how that works? While we were yet sinners, while we were unchanged spiritually, while we were destitute, while we were rebels, while we were enemies, while we were hostile to God, Christ hung on a cross, demonstrating the love of God. Can we take a bow yet? I think not. The wages of sin is death. Somebody had to die. And somebody did. This is the greatest love story that man has ever heard. It never gets better than this one. God, in his choosing, before the foundation of the earth, knew how this all worked out. Christ was the lamb that was slain from the foundation of the earth. God has done it all. There remains absolutely nothing for man to do. He can't fix it. He can't adjust it. Can't make it prettier. Can't make it better. Can't dress it up. It is what it is, and it stands all on its own. So, do you remember that question that Jesus asked Peter and the rest of them? Who do men say that I am? Well, you're a great teacher. You're a mighty prophet. You're a moral teacher. You know, whatever label we want to give him, he's a mystic. Whatever the world might call him. But who do you say that I am? Thou art the Christ. Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. You're the hope. You're the only answer for all of this. So, I guess we're going to wrap it up. We're going to bring it to a conclusion. I ask you, have you been sprinkled with the blood? It's the only thing that can save us. Remember, there's only one sin that can damn us. There's only one blood that can cleanse us. So, who do you say that Jesus is? I mean, that's really the thing we have to answer today. We're done this morning. Thank you.